certificate of compliance that accompanied the deed of the residential asset. Consequently, in section 9 of the Act is constitutional on this account as well. It was passed in gross disregard of provisions of Article 105, 260, and 263 respectively. Issue 11 is therefore answered in the affirmative. Presidential age limit. It is contended by the petitioner in constitutional petition number 10 of 2018 that sections 3 and 7 of the Constitutional Amendment Act 2018, which remove age limits for the president and district chairperson, amended by infection Article 1 of the Constitution, on the power of the people to determine how they should be governed. The two sections state as follows. I'll read, they are quite long. I cannot go through them. I have reproduced all those sections which amended that. The respondent, Isaf Reason, presents a contrary argument that the amendments removing the minimum and maximum age restrictions on eligibility to stand for president simply widen the pool of potential leaders for the people to select from. The petition has also filed the private member's bill in this regard for its claim in a memorandum to the bill that the minimum and the maximum age restriction in the Constitution were discriminatory, thereby opening up a new discrimination category of age under Article 21(3) of the Constitution. In their view, this is not correct, since it also has an impact of undermining the original constituent powers exercised by the members of the Constituent Assembly that passed those restrictions. I have not been able to come across any precedent from any jurisdiction in support of the contention by the petitioners that removal of minimum and or maximum age restrictions from the Constitution amounts to subverting the power of the people whose representatives passed those provisions in the first place. The petitioners did not avail any such precedent for their novel proposition. It is probable that none exists. However, there are judicial precedents in support of the petitioner's arguments to the effect that minimum and the maximum age restrictions do not amount to prohibited discrimination categories in law. I quote the case of Wilford from the United States, where the argument that minimum age restrictions on eligibility to stand for public office is discriminatory was summarily rejected by the trial court, and the New Jersey Supreme Court in the United States of America respectively also did so. In my view, the question as to whether age restrictions are discriminatory does not assist the petitioner's case at all. They are simply making the case that Honorable Magezi provided some partially erroneous justification for his bill insofar as he claimed that minimum and maximum age restrictions are discriminatory. To that extent, I agree with you. However, the heart of the matter is whether the provisions in the Act that have the effect of scrapping the minimum and maximum age restrictions in the Constitution and accounts for eligibility to stand for the office of president and district chairperson do they contravene any existing constitutional provision? That is the question. It's contended that since the people through their representatives in the Constituent Assembly placed those restrictions in the Constitution and that Parliament does not have powers to remove them, that in doing so under Section 3 and 7 of the Act, it has infected Article 1 on people's sovereignty. In terms of the petitioner's view, the basic structure doctrine prohibits such an with the greatest of respect, I am unable to agree with that proposition. If the argument is held that it would be, then it would logically mean that Parliament has absolutely no power to amend any provision of the Constitution, since the entire Constitution was passed by the people's representatives in a constituent assembly. This, in my view, is overstretching the application of the amendment by infection principle, which, if accepted, would in the end render the principle superfluous. The provisions on amendment of the Constitution were enacted by the people's representatives in the Constituent Assembly. Chapter 18 of the Constitution exists for that sole purpose. The argument by the petitioners that the original Constituent Assembly did not make a mistake in enacting the age restrictions is misleading and not tenable, as it would logically be applied to prohibit all possible amendments of the Constitution. I'm therefore unable to agree with the contention that Section 3 and 7 of the Act indirectly affect Act 01 of the Constitution. Further, I'm not convinced that minimum and maximum age restrictions on eligibility for the offices of president and district chairperson in the Constitution amount to such fundamental pillars of the Constitution that doing away with them leaves us with a different instrument altogether. That would be a gross misunderstanding of the basic structure doctrine. Age restrictions cannot be described as part of the values which are enshrined in our Constitution, along with sacrosanct principles such as democratic governance. If it were, then they would have been entrenched like other core values were entrenched in Articles 260 and 741 of the Constitution. Article 741 of the Constitution makes it mandatory for the referendum to be held where the political system in the country to be changed. Finally, I have failed to appreciate the relevance of Article 21 of the Constitution in supporting the petitioner's case. The article prohibits discrimination and lists certain categories which do not include age. Section 7 of the Act are certainly not inconsistent with Article 21 in its present form. If anything, the respondent's argument that Section 3 and 7 have the effect of widening the pool of individuals eligible to stand for the offices of president and district chairperson sounds more persuasive. Article 102 provides that a person is not qualified for election as president unless that person is not less than 35 years and not more than 75 years of age. And Article 183.2, this states that a person is not qualified to be elected district chairperson unless she is at least 30 years and not more than 75 years of age. A reading of Article 102b and Article 183.2b, which before the amendments set age limits, shows that the two constitutional provisions are not entrenched anywhere in the Constitution. The assertion by the petitioners that by amending the two clauses, the will of the people was usurped is not tenable, and Article 1 and 2 of the Constitution were neither amended by colorable legislation nor infection. The reading of the Hansard that attached to the affidavit of Ms. Jean Kibirige, the clerk of parliament, shows that members went for consultations on 27th of September 2017, after the first reading, she stated that in paragraphs at 8 of her affidavit that the August House she convened on the 18th December 2017 after carrying out consultations. Many members, while contributing to the debate on 20th of December 2017, stated that they had consulted their constituents and they were giving the views of the people on the Amendment Act. Honorable Robert Chabulani, Member of Parliament, charged on the his constituency while making his contribution on the bill, on the amendment bill in Parliament, stated that he had traversed the whole country from north to south, from east to west, and everywhere he went, he talked to people, and that the majority were saying, do not amend. Honorable Gegela Tiko averred in paragraph 28 of his affidavit that he held consultations after which he attended the parliamentary session on the 18th of December 2017 when the Constitution Amendment Bill 2017 was presented to the House for the second reading. Clearly, this was consultation regarding Section 3 and 7 of the Amendment. 7. Parliament followed all the procedural requirements in the Constitution. Acts of Parliament and its rules of procedure. There was a bill. Consultation was carried out. The bill was gazetted. The bill was read for the first time and it was referred to the appropriate committee. It was debated and passed. There was a certificate of financial implications by the Minister of Finance, a certificate of compliance by the Speaker of Parliament, and the President assented to it. I find that in enacting Sections 3 and 7 of the Amendment Act, Parliament did so within its powers provided in the Constitution. Consequently, I answer this issue in the negative. and hold that Section 3 and 7 of the Constitution Amendment Act 2018 are constitutional valid and not inconsistent with the provision of the Constitution. Continuous in office of the incumbent president upon attaining the age of 75 years. The crux of the argument advanced in respect of this issue is that upon attaining the age of 75 years, the incumbent president would be in violation of the Constitution, since only an individual below the age of 60, below the said age, is eligible to be president. The Attorney General contends that this argument is rendered moot by passing of the Constitutional Amendment Act 2018. Mr. Malema disagrees. He rightly relies on Semogerere decision to point out that since the Constitutional Amendment Act is still subject to legal challenge, the issue is not academic. In view of my findings in respect to validity of Section 3 and 7 of the Constitutional Amendment Act, I hesitantly resisted the temptation to agree with the Attorney General that this matter is moving. The East African Court of Justice, in the case of Attorney General of the United Republic of Tanzania, against African Network for Animal Welfare, reference number 3 of 2014, described legal mootness as follows. The doctrine of mootness or academic adventure of the courts of justice is well known. The raison d'etre of the courts of justice is to give binding decisions on live disputes. If there is no live dispute for resolution, a court of justice will be wasting the public's resources, time, personnel, and money by engaging in a futile and a vain exposition of the law. The question that I have to answer is whether answering this question is a mere academic exercise, owing to my findings on the validity of Section 3 and 7 of the Amendment Act. If the Constitutional Court was to be the final arbiter on matters of interpretation of the Constitution, I have no doubt in my mind this issue would be moot, not resolving any live issue. However, I have considered the fact that the petitioners in these consolidated petitions have an automatic right of appeal to the Supreme Court. While I cannot speculate as to whether they would choose to exercise that right, I would be doing them a disservice if I declined to determine this matter, and then it subsequently referred back to this court by the Supreme Court, as it has previously happened in the Mogherere case. I will therefore briefly address this issue to avoid such a possibility and obtain closure for the petitioner, Malemi, at least in this court. The Court of Appeal in Ouma Adea, when determined a similar point regarding eligibility of a candidate for election when he is under a criminal conviction under the Anti-Corruption Act, that is subsequent to the appeal. The court considered the effort of Section 95 of the Parliamentary Elections Act, which preserves a member of parliament in parliament when he has been similarly convicted. The question was whether such member, though eligible to remain in the House, he validly nominated in a subsequent election while he she pursues his appeal. The Lordship said that requirements at the time of nomination are different from the import of Section 95 of Parliamentary Elections Act, which preserves in office a convicted member of Parliament. In their view, the said Section 95 is only directed to those already in office and is silent about their eligibility for nomination. Subsequent elections, if they are still pursuing appeals against the, I think the logic of the said decision applies to the question of a candidate who attains the age of 75 while already in office. This particular requirement of maximum age only operates at the time of nomination and not subsequent. If the framers of the Constitution had intended it to be otherwise, they would have expressed the same. So surely they were alive to the fact that candidates close to the age of 75 years would potentially offer themselves to nomination. If they intended that no one should occupy the office of president above the age of 75, they would have expressed the same. So or simply place the maximum age for nomination at 70 years instead. They chose not to. I therefore do not agree with the petition, Mr. Mabu, that a sitting president who attains the age of 75 is liable to forget. That is to misconstrue the import of the age qualification. for answer is to follow in the negative. What remedies are valuable to the parties? I've taken the arguments advanced by both sides into consideration. I already held that sections 2, 5, 6, 8, 9, and 10 of the Constitutional Amendment Act 2018 are unconstitutional for the reasons I discussed. On the other hand, I also held that sections 7, 3, and 7 of the Constitutional Amendment Act are valid. Additionally, none of the parties had any problem with sections 1 and 4 of the Act. Consequently, sections 1, 3, and 4 of the Act remain in place and have not been struck down. The Land Solicitor General submitted that in the event that we find certain clauses of the impugned Act to be invalid, they should be declared null and leave the rest that are valid. That approach was applied in the Supreme Court. Was applied by the Supreme Court in the case of Attorney General against Salvatore Abuffi, where section 7 of the Witchcraft Act was nullified, but sections 2 and 3 were upheld and invalid. Black's Law Dictionary 9th edition defines severance as the separation by the court of the claims of multiple parties, either to permit separate actions in the claim or to allow certain interlocutory orders to become final. Lord Denning, Master of Rolls, in Kingsway Investments case, stated that this question of severance has been to the law for centuries. Ever since Peabody's case in 1774, seeing that in this case the condition is said to be void, because it is repugnant to the Act, I am tempted to go back to the old distinction taken by Lord Hobart when he said the statute is like a tyrant. Where he comes, he makes all void. But the common law is like a nursing father, makes void only that part where the fault is, and preserves the rest. I prefer to take the principle from the notes in the English reports in Bigot's case. The general principle is that if any clause, etc., void by statute or by common law, be mixed with the good matter, which is entirely independent, if the good part stands, the rest is void. But if the part which is good depends upon that which is bad, the whole instrument is void. Similarly, in South African National Defense Union case against Minister for Defense in that country, the same approach was applied, as is evident from this passage. The offending provisions, however, can be rendered the constitutional void by the technique of severance applied to both subsections 2 and 4 of section 126. It's quite possible to sever the various references to acts of the public process from section 126b entirely, as well as the definition of acts of public process contained in section 126. The challenge provisions would then remain only as a prohibition against strike action against the incitement to strike, something which the applicant did not see. In my view, that is the proper course of action to take. The provisions of the Act that were either not challenged or challenged unsuccessfully are good law, and those amendments to the Constitution that they provide for must be upheld. In the circumstances, I hold that sections 4, 5, 6, 8, 9, and 10 of the Constitutional Amendment Act are hereby struck down and expunged from the Act. Sections 1, 3, 4, and 7 of the Act are upheld since they are constitutionally valid. On the question of costs, the petition has brought various petitions of considerable merit and have been successful in respect of various provisions of the Act. However, the Attorney General also successfully defended portions of the Act that have been upheld as having been valid in the past. Certainly, the prayer for damages by one of the petitioners is misplaced in the matters of this nature. He did not demonstrate that suffered any special loss by reason of the enactment of the Act. I have taken into consideration that this petition is such a matter of great public importance and of constitutional governance of this country that transcends any unique benefit to the beneficiary, to the petitioners. However, due to the peculiar circumstances of this case, including the fact that it was heard in Bali and the petitioners had to incur costs beyond what they would have ordinarily incurred, I find it appropriate that they get some costs. The Honorable Deputy Chief Justice has in his judgment set the amount to be paid. I agree with the reasons and the award he has made. I therefore make the following orders in respect to the consolidation. One, a declaration is hereby issued that sections 2, 5, 6, 8, 9, and 10 of the Constitutional Amendment Act 2018 are unconstitutional, as the same are inconsistent with various provisions of the Constitution. Order hereby issued expunging sections 2, 5, 6, 8, 9, and 10 from the Constitutional Amendment Act 2018. Declaration is hereby issued that sections 1, 3, 4, and 7 of the Constitutional Amendment Act are valid. And professional fees, costs, as I have ordered, as I have said, are awarded. Dated this day of 26 July 2018 in Mbale, undersigned by Honorable Justice Parisha Keborion, Justice of the Constitutional Court. I thank you.
Thank you, my lord. Learned Council, ladies and gentlemen, that's the first judgment of the court. We will break for 45 minutes to have a health break and other things, and then we continue at exactly 2:45. Court is adjourned till then.